world of e-commerce can be tricky, and that's why you need the experts to help take you to the next level. This is Delivering E-Commerce, and this is Chris Parsons.
Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of Delivering E-Commerce, and I'm your host, Chris Parsons. Thank you all for joining us. I am super, super pleased to be able to bring you two fine gentlemen. I don't know how fine, but maybe fine like an old bottle of wine. We have Andrew Summerton and Dan Duran. Guys, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Chris. Great to be here.
Thank you for having us.
Great. Let's kick off right away. So, Andrew, you follow the podcast. You've seen some of the episodes. And, you know, I love to get my guests to really go in depth and talk about their journey and how they ended up where they are today. I think it gives really, especially with, you know, how many people were influencing, a great story that it's a zigzag in most careers. It's not just this straight up path to get to where you are today. So if we can start there, Andrew, with you, and then Dan, we'll get onto your journey, which is fascinating as well.
What are you talking about? Andrew's story is like a rocket. It's like super straight, right?
Yeah,
Andrew?
That had no
failures at all.
Up and down.
Did you just win the lottery and you're good?
That's exactly right. Yeah, I know. Chris, it's my pleasure. And to everybody watching, absolutely. You know, the journey I've had, I'm an old man, or at least Dan always likes to remind me of that. I've had an incredible journey. I've been very fortunate to be a part of many organizations, from the ownership side to the failure side, to working for organizations. And you know what? Through the entire journey, I've learned an awful lot. And one of the biggest things I've realized is time is our most valuable commodity. And when individuals are giving me their time, which is their most valuable commodity, and I'm giving them theirs, I'm giving them mine, it's about a win-win situation. And you take away those experiences and hopefully you apply them to your journey. And a lot of my experiences haven't been great. I've failed businesses. I've lost lots, an awful lot. I've had huge wins where you think it's a win, and then all of a sudden, like, you're riding a high, you're on a wave, and you realize those waves crash. And it's how you pick yourself up and how you continue to move forward and how you grow. And really what's important is surrounding yourself with really incredible people. And so, where I am.
Like yourself, Chris.
There you go, like yourself, Chris. And Dan. But through those experiences, if you continue to pick yourself up and continue to brush yourself off and learn from good people, you hopefully grow as a person. And that's really what success is all about. It's not necessarily financial. It's about growing as a person and making yourself better and making your experiences influence other people and having great experiences with them. So my business experience has been up and down. I'm certainly in a really great position right now. Bwired Technologies and Rhyno Cybersecurity, we're flourishing. We have some really great partnerships. We have an incredible organization. Our team, I couldn't ask for a better team. Our product and
great partner too.
Yeah, my partner's okay. You learn a little bit about him. But overall,
very knowledgeable.
Overall, Chris, that's kind of my journey on a very surface level. Lots of peaks and valleys, but I'm still here. I'm still breathing, and I'm still smiling because I'm surrounded by great people like yourselves.
Well, what I love about that's three times actually that you mentioned people. And the key to success is being around great people. And I often say to my team, because I hire for multiple gaps that I have, I don't want people that are exactly like me. I want them to be better than me, and I want them to fulfill the gaps that I have in my skill set. And I always say, if I'm the smartest person in the room, then we're in trouble.
Absolutely. Because
I should not be the smartest person in the room based on hiring great talent. And 100%. Every team I've ever managed is the reason I succeed, is because I'm just the vision, and they have to bring all of this to life. And it's so important, even through the ups and downs and failures, you have great teams that fail too. But it is surrounding yourself with great people. And I'm glad you touched on that at least three times in that opening. So that was fantastic.
Yeah.
My pleasure. And Dan, let's get into you.
Sure. Thank you, Chris. And you know, it's a real pleasure to be on your show. I'm a fan. I have subscribed to your channel on YouTube. Great channel. I also clicked on the little bell. So every time you have content, I always get the notifications and I watch your show. So I invite everybody to watch Chris's show. So informational. I had no idea about e-commerce until I started watching your shows, and you had some really good guests in your show. So kudos to you, Chris. I'm very happy to be here in this show. And you know what? Andrew and I, we're business partners, and we're like Batman and Robin, right? So Andrew's it's bad man. Yeah, he's bad man. He can be bad man, but I'm the better looking half of his the partnership, right?
And you both like wearing tights, okay?
Exactly.
In underwear on top, okay? So yeah, my story is it's a bit different. It's kind of like one of those rags to riches stories. So I come from a small country in South America called Chile, and I immigrated when I was 70 years old. And I lived in a very poor area in the capital of Chile, which is Santiago. And I remember being a little kid and just running around on the dirt streets with no shoes on. Like that's how poor we were. Like we had nothing. Absolutely, we were living in basically shacks. Like we only had like a very simple roof on top of our heads. And we didn't have like the floor was made out of dirt. Like we didn't have water, running water. We had to go and get water from this place, and we didn't have electricity. So it was very tough. It was very tough. But you know what? Friends and people that love you were kind of like our main way of coping with life, mm-hmm. right? Then I came to Canada when I was 16, 17 years old, didn't know any English. I had a rough time in here too. So I was brought over and unfortunately things didn't work out. I was living on my own, but then I always had that thing in my head, you know, you come from such a really precarious conditions in South America and Chile from a country. And for some reason you're here. You got to have something. You're special. You have to have something in you that is doing this. I don't believe in coincidences, right? So I always thought that I was special, and my mom used to tell me that all the time.
My mom did too, but it wasn't for the reasons.
You're special, all right. Yeah.
That was the conversation my parents had with me. You're special.
You know what? Now my wife, so Tamara, if you're listening to this this talk, she tells me all the time that I'm special too. Right. So that's there you go. So, anyways, so I always had this thing, and I remember working at a donut shop, frying donuts, while I was going to school full time, grade 10. And working my ass off, like just frying donuts, this was like a wholesale donut place that they make donuts for all the Tim Horton around the area. So it's pretty big enterprise in just flipping donuts. And you know, I still went through high school and I got really good grades. For some reason, I got really good grades. I study quite a bit. I love studying. That's something that I always had, that I love every day. I pretty much read, like 1 or 2 hours a day in different subjects. Now I'm getting into cybersecurity. And I have my, so I was able to get good grades. And then all of a sudden, one of my uncles, after I finished school, because that I was like basically a deadbeat with good marks, with good grades. My uncle one day tells me, listen, have you even considered going to college or applying to something? And I'm like, you know what? It makes sense. I'm just going to try it out. So I applied to University of Waterloo. I applied to Conestoga College here in town, right? We're from Kitchener, Waterloo. I applied to Wilfrid Laurier. And sure enough, I got accepted to Wilfrid Laurier. And I applied actually 1 week late. So everybody had applied already. And the person in there actually put me in a conditional or a probationary status. She said, if you don't get good marks, like 70% or something like that, you won't be able to make it. So I'll put you part-time. You're really late applying. I'm like, have you heard of this thing called OSEP? I have no idea what OSEP is. So it was very kind of like spur of the moment. I'm just going to apply. And I begged a lady. And when she looked at my marks, she's like, oh, you have really good marks. So even though everybody applied super earlier than what I did, right? Mm-hmm. And I got in. I finished. I graduated from economics and business. Then I went on to work for some really good organizations that are multinational. I was a marketing manager in one of them. And then I started escalating into other places until I'm like, you know what? I love doing this, but I want to do it on my own. So I went, I had a really stable salary with bonuses, with a car allowance, all of that. And I'm like, you know, I can deal with this.
And then you went to become an entrepreneur. What are you thinking?
I can do this. I totally got it. As soon as I started working on my own, I just tell them, okay, you know, 2 weeks notice, I got to go. My salary dropped probably 75%. I owe that. I owned a house, with my wife, and I went through freaking hell, heck, right? I don't know if I want to say hell, right? You might cut that up, but I went through a really rough time after. So that was my first lesson after I graduated, you know, how, you know, like business, it's a totally different ballgame.
I know this is about you, but in all fairness, those guys out there listening and watching, entrepreneurial, and being an entrepreneur is not all it's cut out to be. So just, you know, be very, very open up and listen to Dan carefully, because it's it can be great, but it can also be a really tough journey.
Yeah, if you wanna get kicked on the butt, punch on the teeth, and fall, then start your own business, right?
That's right.
But then there's the other side, all right? I love working on my own. I love being, you know, like an entrepreneur and doing things and having ideas and doing all of this. So after that, all of this, now I've been able to get my master's of business administration from University of Illinois. And then I have a few certifications. So I'm always upgrading myself. And now we have this wonderful company called Bwired Technologies and Rhyno Cybersecurity. So it's a long, convoluted story, but that's what it is, Chris.
But you know what, Chris, to Dan's credit, he's probably in all fairness, and back to me being old, I've met an awful lot of people. And Dan is truly probably one of the most passionate and educated individuals I know. And he is always striving to do better and learn more. And that's not blowing sunshine there, Dan. Yeah, yeah. It's reality. You are a pretty smart guy.
What I love, Dan, is you said it's not coincidence. And I think what certain people have is the ability to manifest where they want to go and set targets and set step-by-step goals and achieve them. So even if there is failures along the way, you have these milestones that are reminding you that you're making progress,
right?
So even if you take a step back, you're still, maybe it's you want to have a salary of 100,000, or maybe you wanted to, you know, launch your own business. You have these targets. And as long as you keep these targets in mind and these goals in mind, the rest of the stuff doesn't matter.
That's right.
And I feel like a lot of people just get frustrated when they have setbacks, but ultimately keep the goal in mind. It's never smooth. And as an entrepreneur, because I've launched a number of my own businesses, and I haven't quite had the courage to give up my full-time job to do my own business instead of the full-time job, but I do know how hard it is. And I know the double-ended sort of working all day for a retailer and then working all evening and night for myself. And I don't have the pressure because I can still pay my bills, but wanting something to be successful and working twice is difficult. So good on you for taking that leap of faith. And, you know, one of my good friends, Johnny, says, bet on yourself. And that's clearly what you did, is you bet on yourself. So good for you.
Absolutely.
Let's talk about
your, ahead. And it's not about the destination, right? It's always about the journey. And people, they think that they want to make themselves rich overnight, it's not all about your salary and the money. There's so many intrinsic things and things that you can accomplish to make you happy. It's whatever makes you happy, man. That's the key, right? Whatever makes you passionate, that's what you've got to follow.
Great. Love it, guys. So Andrew, let's talk about this business, your partnership, your relationship. How did you guys meet? Did you have dinner together? was it strictly platonic at the start?
He was a dancer at one of these places that.
That's right. Actually, it's kind of a funny story, because I was one of Dan's first clients, actually, if I remember correctly, Dan. Years ago, I owned a company called Key to the City. It's a national loyalty brand program, and it was a card that you showed and saved. We had, you know, many, many roadside assistance providers across North America. And and the company was, again, called Key to the City.
I had this key.
Did you? Wonderful. So nice.
Really?
I did. So this is not set up at all. So this is blowing me away, because I actually wanted to start, a friend of mine, Todd Shapiro, used to host a talk radio show on Sirius Satellite. And him and I wanted to start this business where we offered through social media some kind of group, and that's, you know, kind of exclusive, opportunity where they can go into restaurants and they would get 10% off because all they had to do was show this card or whatnot. And he was like, dude, that's a great idea, but there's something called Key to the City. You're a little bit late on this. And he got me one.
So, well, that's very cool. I love hearing that because
that's crazy.
So Dan, we reached out to Dan as a developer when he was first launching Bwired. And he actually built our first site for us for Key to the City and
eCommerce.
First
eCommerce.
That's right. And it was a good little business. We had huge visions of grandeur. We went national. Well, not national. It was basically in multiple cities with the vision of going national. And then we ended up entering into a partnership with an organization that unfortunately went a little sideways. I won't want to get into that because it's never about bad mouthing anybody or any organization. It was a journey and we learned from it, but it was a wonderful, wonderful experience. And what's really great about that experience is Dan and I formed this relationship. And through his professionalism and our mutual, you know, love for the outdoors, respect for one another, he would come to Ottawa every so often. We'd visit, we'd go for bike rides, go out for dinner, and just kind of kept the relationship alive. And then a couple years later, I looked into another organization business that I owned, and we reached out to Dan. Dan helped with that. And then full circle, Dan and I now are partners with Bwired Technologies and Rhyno Cybersecurity. So it was business related, but also mutually through enjoying and being friendly with one another, which was really, really great.
Exactly. I remember going with my wife to Montreal, for example, or Quebec City, and then passing by Ottawa and visiting you, spending a few days at your place, right? And then having dinner with you. And then I remember you taking us out to fireworks in Ottawa and stuff like that. So it was more than just a business
100%.
Relationship. It was more of a friendship. And then what happened is I had another business partner, and I'm not that type of guy that's going to say bad things about other people, but things didn't work out. Mm-hmm. We had a fallout, right? And then I was left on my own, and I'm like, okay, so what do I do now? So I can't just build a business on my own. I need some sort of somebody to support me or people to support me. And then Andrew was the first person that came to mind. So one day I'm like, hey, buddy, do you want half of this business?
Right.
And it was the good half and also the bad half, because we owe so much money to the government and back taxes and all kinds of like stuff, right? So,
he was like, absolutely.
But I think the thing that always kept us afloat was the fact that we had solid, really solid clients and long and big clients. For example, we can say that some of our clients are Linamar, which is a $7.6 billion company, Skyjack, MacDon, Gencore, all over billion-dollar companies that we've able to maintain over the years for over 7 to 10 years. They've been in our show as well, right? So we have really good clients that always believed in us, and we always did a superb job in every aspect of what we did for them, and that kept us afloat, and now we're thriving, right?
I think the key there, though, the key message is people need to get from what you guys both have just said is about relationships. You guys built a relationship with each other, and you build relationships with your clients, and that's why they both are long lasting. Your friendship's long lasting, and the relationships with your clients is long lasting because of the relationships you build, which is great. And you don't get that from a lot of partners. It's a lot of partners.
Absolutely.
Let's sign a contract and then see where things go from there instead of building the relationship. So
yeah.
Good
yeah.
on you. I want to get into the details of Bwired and what you guys actually do and how you can support anyone that may be watching.
Beautiful. Dan, I think as a technology guy, I think you should come from you.
Sure. We do e-commerce, right? And we work with Shopify, for example. So we are a Shopify partner. We work with WooCommerce. So WordPress, WooCommerce. We have built several websites using WordPress. If you want to be in the more of the social aspects of a website, so you can have blogs and do all kinds of activities aside the e-commerce side.
Yeah, Dan, let me just jump in for 1 second, because I think we touched on this when I had the pleasure of being on your podcast.
Yes,
that each platform has its key benefit, its key strength, and
exactly
whether it's a Magento or WorkArea, Kibo, all of them have something different. So you need to really define as a business owner what you want from a specific technology, then you guys can make the recommendation of what technology to use, because they all offer something slightly different. So go ahead.
Yes, absolutely. It all starts with your long-term plan, right? What do you want to accomplish in, you know, 2 or 3 years from now, right? And then build it from there. So we've worked with Magento several times. We've done Magento sites. We've worked with ASP.NET application. So from the Microsoft side, NopCommerce, for example, for heavy integration into ERPs and internal systems, it works very well, right? So it really depends on what you want to do, on your scalability, basically, right?
And then, so from there, you guys are helping build e-commerce websites, but you also talk really a lot about security and how to make people, like, especially the last 20 years of e-commerce is all about people feeling secure from a transaction perspective. And then also the owner of a website, making sure that you're not exposing any of your clients to risks. So this is a big topic for you guys on a regular basis. And how did that come about?
Yeah, maybe Andrew, you can explain that part.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's as we know, and as we've seen over the last few years, I mean, everybody has, you know, changed their work habits. They're working from home. They're always live on their phones, literally, or their, you know, their tablets or their home computers. But the businesses have to adapt. And as they adapt, cybersecurity criminals have adapted. And, you know, the business world has dramatically changed, right? And more people are buying, as you said, Chris, are buying online and the e-commerce stores. And, you know, about 5 years ago, we identified a need for high-speed hosting and backups and security on a surface level for our big corporations. We decided as technology, a technology infrastructure, why should we outsource this? Why shouldn't we do this on our own? And we did. And so it kind of became a hidden business for us within Bwired Technologies. About 4 years ago, 3 years ago, it became a mainstream Rhyno Cybersecurity, where we actually, as technology officers, we built an MDR, a managed detection and response solution, in-house, which we deploy in you know, companies' networks. We do penetration tests and vulnerability tests to assess networks and websites to see where those vulnerabilities are. And then we give very thorough and detailed reports to either IT departments, MSPs, you know, the corporations, to make sure they're protected, or we help them. Mm-hmm. And what's really important about this is that layer of security. And then the most important part of all of it, and I'm gonna steal Dan's thunder a little bit. He likes to call, you know, cybersecurity an onion, right? There's multiple layers, but the ultimate layer is the human component. And it's knowledge base. So, you know, as a e-commerce store owner or a business owner or as an individual, being knowledgeable about what you should be doing and how you should be doing to protect yourself or protect your website or protect your service or your own property is critical. And, you know, right now, I'll just throw that out there. It's actually Cybersecurity Awareness Month. October is Cybersecurity Awareness Month. So there's so much information out there for people to learn and educate themselves. But yes, if you're looking at going into the e-commerce business, you know, full circle to why we're here, you know, the technology side of things that Dan's talking to is critical. But the nice thing about what we do is because we marry the two. We're Bwired Technologies first, and we're Rhyno Cybersecurity now simultaneous, like together. Yeah. So when we build, we think about those components. And I think you as an individual, if you're out there thinking about that, whoever you partner with, that should be top of mind when you're building your site and how it's built and what you're doing to protect yourself.
So my follow-up question on that is, it's great that you're providing the secure structure and infrastructure of a website and all of the best practices that go along with it. But a lot of entrepreneurs don't know the rules and regulations. Like, if you get hacked, mm-hmm. there's certain things you have to declare within a certain amount of time, and you have to go public with what was at risk. Do you also offer those guidances and advice to your clients to be like, hey guys, this just happened, this breach happened, and you've got, I don't know if it's 15, 30 days, whatever that time frame, you guys would know better than me, but there's specific things that a retailer or a businessman has to take once, because even though you guys are putting in all the best practices in the world,
right,
they get smarter and smarter every day.
100%. Yeah.
And you have to keep reacting and try to be ahead of them. But what advice do you do to help out any of your partners in the situation that they've beat your firewalls, they've beat your protection?
Right. Oh, yeah. So it, you know, like Chris, it is a can of worm. Okay. I'm not going to lie, man.
Yeah.
And this subject is, is so very important, right? It's so easy to scan a website using everyday tools, and never mind if you're an actual hacker and see vulnerabilities on that website and then hack the website, right? So it happens all the time. It happens all the time. When our clients come to us, like today, for example, we had a consultation with one of our, with a prospect. You see it everywhere. You see it everywhere. The software is outdated. Yeah. The servers are outdated. And there's something very important that people don't know about this, but it's called PII. And PII is personally identifiable information. Okay. So your name, for example, Chris Parsons, your email address, your phone number, your address, where you work, all of those pieces of data are PII. And if you get hacked and that information is stolen from whatever database you have inside of your e-commerce, for example, you can be liable according to the government. So this has nothing to do with e-commerce either. It has to do with just putting people at risk. Mm-hmm. And when you're dealing with e-commerce, and if you're dealing with transactions, there is something called PCI DSS, right? So which it is the main entity that controls any transaction that have to do with credit cards. So that's even worse. Then you really have to focus on not holding any data on your servers that belongs, or credit card information and things like that, right? So I'm not trying to put the fire of God on anybody here, but the first thing that you have to do is do a vulnerability assessment on your site to see how you're doing, right? How your e-commerce is doing. So, and I know, you know, small entrepreneurs, you're really saturated with things to do in the operational, you know, everyday things that you have to do. Shipping, logistics, marketing, sales. You wear many hats, but unfortunately, you have to wear a cybersecurity hat as well.
Well, I mean, to that point, Dan, I think, you know, we as you know, human beings, we love to procrastinate. I say this all the time, but with this... With
no,
this,
we don't.
This, yeah.
Nobody.
Well, let's talk about it later, actually. No, in regards to that, though, I mean, we all like to procrastinate. And the reality of it is you don't want to procrastinate with cybersecurity, because you don't want to be proactive. You want to be proactive. You don't want to be reactive, because it's too late at that point. And so to answer your question also, Chris, in regards to do we help the clients? So yeah, we help them create a cybersecurity landscape, kind of an outline of their entire business, and take them from where they are to where they need to be. And we do that in stages. And part of that, though, is the execution of, you know, what happens if, what do we do when? All those type of things. How are your employees being trained? What services do you need, or do you already have in place that you don't, you know, that we can build this service on top of? So, you know, to answer your question, like I said, yes, we do when we help them with that, but every client, every service, every industry is different and has different rules and regulations. But absolutely, that's part of our process.
And that's the key that I want to get from the both of you, is that this is an ongoing, that's constantly learning. It's a continuous improvement. And anyone getting into this, likely they're not going to have the expertise in cybersecurity. It's just they're focused on the products that they want to get to market. They're focused on their business and marketing strategies, Dan, as you said so well there. And this is something that I always believe, if you're going to have expertise in-house, be good at what you're good at and outsource the other stuff, right?
Yeah, like, absolutely.
Because otherwise you're going to do it half-assed, and you're going to set yourself up for a lot of risk. It may not fail you, but you'll definitely be at risk.
Well, there's a percentage, Chris, that, you know, in life or business, we always allocate X number of business to marketing. And there is a percentage, and Dan, I'll let you talk to the percentage, but there is a percentage that you should be allocating at this time moving forward, and it's constantly increasing, to your cybersecurity landscape of your business. It was never in people's, you know, vision. It was just always put to the side. I don't need it. I don't want it. Now it's a must. It's an absolute must. And Dan, I don't want to quote the wrong numbers. What is the percentage of your budget that should be allocated to your cybersecurity?
Yes. So protection. They say IT and cybersecurity is about 10 to 15%. Cybersecurity from a web, I would say at least 5% of your budget should be allocated to cybersecurity, right?
Yeah.
And I think, Chris, that you said something that is very critical. don't do it on your own. Don't do it on your own. Yeah. Because even if you have a, let's say, a WordPress site and it's easy to keep up to date and just, update your plugins and the core of your WordPress, chances are that one day you're going to do that update and the site is going to crash somehow. Something happened, the update didn't work, and it crashed. How do you restore that site from a backup? You know, what is the downtime that you're going to have? So leave it to the experts to be able to handle that. And it's not very expensive if you do it. Okay, so it is expensive if you let it go. If you don't do it for a year or 2 years, you're not taking care of your e-commerce constantly, continuously. It can be very expensive. However, if day by day, month by month, you're doing those security updates, you're keeping up with security, then it's much easier, right? On your wallet, right? Because it becomes a gradual progression in cybersecurity, as opposed to, you know, all of a sudden one day you have to do all of these things, right?
Yeah, I talk about cybersecurity, and this is a stupid analogy, but I always talk about it with regards to like your lifestyle and how you treat your body. Because if you let your body go over 5 or 10 years and you don't do anything about it, it's really costly to get back into shape and get into those right eating habits and get to your ideal weight. But if you maintain yourself, you don't have to worry about those big expenses and going through that nightmarish procedure. Same with cybersecurity. If you stay on top of it and you partner with somebody that's strong, you have first peace of mind, you can sleep at night. And then the second piece is that you have the confidence that you've done absolutely everything you can to be compliant and make sure that you're not, everyone's at risk, but you're not at risk as much as others. So,
absolutely. You got it right on.
Sure. And to what you were saying earlier, Chris, about doing what you do well and then, or bringing in a partner or an expert. I mean, every single day we live, eat, sleep, and breathe this for our clients. We're learning each and every day because we're living it and every day. So imagine if you're just coming into it or you're not knowledgeable, you don't have the knowledge. You're always, this is a type of business. You're always growing, always learning, because it's always adapting, just like marketing, you know, just like IT, you know, the technology is advancing faster than we can actually keep up with. Cybersecurity is the same way, right? So we're always morphing and doing better and making better solutions and better products and services and evaluating and training. And so if we're doing that each and every day and you're not, think how much stuff you're still not learning, you know, each and every day, because we're always learning and we're in the business, right? So it's just something to keep in mind for sure.
Right. So right now my audience is saying, okay, you've sold me. How do I get a hold of you guys? So Andrew, how do people get a contact with yourself? And then Dan, same thing.
Yeah. So, I mean, either you can reach out to us at sales@bwired.ca sales@rhyno.ca. Or you can reach out to me directly at andrew@rhyno.io, not .ca, I apologize, andrew@rhyno.io or dan@rhyno.io, just to reach out to us. And we'll definitely have ourselves reach out back to you, or we'll have one of our team members reach back out to you. Or you can just visit our site, which is probably the easiest, rhyno.io. So rhyno.io.
I'm a little more social. So just look for me in any social media, hashtag Dan Duran. You search for hashtag Dan Duran altogether, Dan Duran, and you'll find me.
Yeah, you blew up on TikTok, eh? So everyone can find you now there.
That's right.
I went like 3,000 followers overnight just by posting one or two videos in there. So I'm trying to design my strategy for TikTok right now.
That's fantastic. So let's jump onto your podcast. You guys have been hosting a podcast now for a number of months. It's noon hour on Fridays.
Yeah.
And you've had some great guests and clients as well. And I know you had one special guest from Delivering E-Commerce. And
he was the best, man.
Yes, we did. He was great.
But tell our audience how to tune in and catch you guys.
The Tech Lounge. Andrew, go ahead. You know, tell the people.
Hey, I don't know if I want you to throw me under the bus. I was nervous each and every time for the first three. I said, Dan, are you kidding me? You're gonna put me in front of the TV or the screen an hour every single day. But you know what? I truly, truly enjoy it. And it is. It's the Tech Lounge every Friday from 12 o'clock to 1 o'clock. And we have incredible guests. We have great topics. It's just for anybody watching. It's nothing to do with sales. It's purely information. It's really educational. you can take a lot away from it. So whether you're just trying to learn something about, whether it be technology driven, whether it be cybersecurity driven, those are really our two main topics. That's why we actually had Chris on in regards to, delivering e-commerce.
Yes.
But yeah, we have a lot of fun with it. And it's exactly like this podcast. And it's just a bunch of guys talking, having a good time, sharing information.
Yeah. The first couple of times, Chris, I'm not going to lie, man, it was a disaster.
I don't know about disaster, but it was nerve-wracking.
I think we have like one person watching.
Yeah. It's humbling, right?
My wife.
I find that like even the other day, I had 100 people subscribe to come on my live Q&A. Nice. So I was really, really excited to be hosting it. 10 people showed up.
Well, but you know what? People actually watch you offline, right? A lot of people do. Like we will notice that we find ourselves or find people watching our videos offline and then requesting the links to the video and all of that. So at the end of the day, it still works.
At the end of the day, too, it's really not about, we'd love to be talking to 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 people. But you know what? If we're talking to 10 people that are truly interested and we're helping them, that's all that really matters. And it is about building a community. And I'm not saying that because I want those 10 people to, speak volumes about us. The reality is it's true. If you're speaking, if you're helping one person each and every show or being able to deliver really great content that's going to help them, then we're doing our job. And that's what it's all about. It's about building community and building, knowledge for whoever's watching and interested. And I truly believe that.
Yeah. And if those 10 people get value out of it, then they will become advocates of your show. So I wasn't too disappointed on the 10. And ultimately there were so many good questions with the 10 people. Anyways, the hour went by in a heartbeat and couldn't have fit any more questions in anyways. But it's trying to, as you guys know, trying to find the right time, the right day, all of these things really are, it's a test and learn. And I know you're locked down on Fridays right now at noon, which gives that consistency, which is great.
You know what I find? We've been very blessed, Chris, and I hopefully you have as well. I have not, even those nervous few times, I have not one time sat there and said, oh my goodness, we have still 15 minutes left in the show. It's like, holy, I can't believe an hour's gone by.
Yeah.
Because we have so much fun. It's just fun. We're just talking about what we know and what we feel truly is going to be helpful for our audience. And not one time have I thought that, oh my goodness, we have 20 minutes left. What are we going to do? We've been good. We've been lucky.
Great. Yeah, it's not like Joe Rogan, that can maintain a show for 3 hours and still have hundreds of thousands of people watching it, right? But it is fun, and we do a lot of interaction with our audience who post questions and stuff like that, send us hearts and hellos and stuff like that. So we try to keep it lively and interactive at all times.
For sure.
I mean, but you know what? You guys could, and I know with the knowledge I have, we could host 3-hour podcasts and still have the same fun. And it would be nice. And I think, manifesting again, and the goal is to have hundreds of thousands of people and supporting them. And maybe with our topics, because they're a little bit more niche, you don't get the big 100,000s. But, it certainly would be nice to have an audience of 5 to 10,000 people on a regular basis and letting them know. But it takes time, right? He was a TV celebrity, UFC. Right. He had all of this already. Absolutely. Attention on him. So while I do enjoy his podcasts, it does take a long time to get up that that word of mouth and have it starting to spread. So,
absolutely. Or you can go on TikTok. You go on TikTok live on TikTok, and you can just count people. Okay, for every people that shows up, I'll put an X, and then you start creating a picture, and just 3 hours go by, and there you go.
You could do that, but it's about consistency, right? It's just about being there and being committed to it, and not realizing it's going to happen overnight. The reality of it is, everything that's worth doing is going to take time. And just love it. And if you love it and you get 10 people one week and 100 next week, it's good. You're going to continue to grow that community. So,
Yes.
Great. So, we'll not take too much more time because 40 minutes on a podcast is tough when most of my audience drives about 20 minutes. I found out from the stats, and this is now the drive to work and the drive home.
Cool.
I wanted to do just talk though. Is there anything from your industry that you wanted to be like, people should be contacting you, reaching out? And this is not a sales thing, but just more of a knowledge of the industry. Like for me, my biggest thing, I called it 2 months ago with a podcast that was on for a company called Oxygen Plus, that Christmas was going to be a disaster this year. And I said, shop early, shop right. early, because the stuff is not going to be on shelves.
You said that on our show too.
And I said right. it on yours. And here we are, and you can walk any store. I challenge you to go to any store, and the shelves are, they're front facing stuff, and they're hiding holes. And it's been something that I still think there's time to get your Christmas gifts, and but you got to do it in October, and you're not going to get it in December like guys typically shop 48 hours before the deadline. But from your industry, is there anything that you're seeing that people should be aware of and look to get more insight on?
Yeah, the problem is that, you know, like the season is coming, right? And we're going to see Black Friday and then getting to Christmas season and all of that. And this is the time when hackers ramp up, right? Because there's a lot of people buying from e-commerce. So I'll tell you what, Chris, anybody that watches this show and it's a fan at delivering e-commerce and subscribe to Chris's delivering e-commerce channel on YouTube and on LinkedIn, we'll give them a free vulnerability assessment on their website or e-commerce, completely free, $500 value.
Whoa.
I just have to talk to my CEO.
It just surprised the hell out of the audience. Are you kidding me?
Edit that out.
Well, no, I have to run it through Andrew, but I'm pretty sure he'll be okay with that. Just come to us and we'll give you that absolutely free just for watching delivering e-commerce.
I think to your question too, and that's great, Dan, and I agree with that, because what I was going to say, if you're out there and you're asking and you're thinking about different things, you should be looking at either a penetration test or a vulnerability test on your company, depending on the size you are, so you can identify your vulnerability, so you know where you are as far as your cybersecurity risks. So reach out to us or an organization like us to help you do that, because you need to know where you are, where you stand in a cybersecurity concern, and where your landscape is, and what you need to protect yourself. In regards to your website, reach out to us through Bwired, and you know what, you should be either looking to make sure your website's updated, it's being hosted on maybe a private server versus a shared server, because speed and functionality is really, really important. Maybe giving it a facelift, maybe giving it more call to actions, making their user journey a little bit more friendly, as far as once you get somebody there, you got to make sure that they can communicate with you. So a couple little...
Right, Andrew? Like redundancy on your servers is key, because you reach peak capacity that you have never got before, and all of a sudden your site's down. You have to
Great
have...
point.
Backup on those servers,
and absolutely,
I think high availability on your server and also CDN, right? So I have a top 10 for e-commerce. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you want me to go through them really quickly.
Yeah, please do,
Chris. Okay, number one, HTTPS, right? So make sure you have a valid good security certificate on your site. Number two, make sure that your server is secure, so the permissions, anything that has to do with the server is up to date, right? Number three, your program or your e-commerce might have flaws. So, you know, cross-site scripting, SQL injections, it might be prone to that. Make sure that that is also fortified, right? Number four, if you have a WordPress or if you have any of these CMS or e-commerce, even Magento, make sure that it's always up to date, right? So do the backups, do the security updates. Number five, MFA, so multi-factor authentication. When you go into the backend, make sure that the administration portal, you have some sort of factor authentication, multi-factor authentication using, you know, your Google Authenticator or any other type of authentication. Even turn that feature on for users that log in, so they have the option of turning that on. Right.
So that's a feature where I have to sign in twice to get into any of my stuff. I hate it, but it's great.
It works. Yeah, it works. And you know what? Every social media also does it, like Facebook and Twitter. They have multi-factor authentication, and you can do multiple things. So it's not just your authenticator. It's also, you know, there's a hot link where you click, and then the application sends you an email with a link where you go to your email or a text message OTP. That's called OTP or one-time passwords. Mm-hmm. There's different ways that you can do multi-factor authentication. If you have one or two or three options for users, they might be inclined to using one of them, right? Yeah. So hide your backend. If you go to site/admin, make sure that it's not there. It's somewhere else. You have some sort of URL that you can do.
What number was that?
That's number six, right? Number seven, whitelisting. So the backend to your e-commerce should be whitelisted. What that means is that only one IP address or two IP address can access that. And an IP address is basically what's given to you on your computer where you are, right? By your ISP, right? So like, you know, Rogers or Bell, et cetera. And that's unique, right? So if you can whitelist your IP address, so that means I can access the backend through only my office and nowhere else, you know? So that's mm-hmm. very important. Number eight, backups. Not just one, have two or three backups, because if one backup fails at the moment when your site crashes, you're still going to be on the red, right? So make sure you have multiple backups for your site and in different, not in the same server, in different servers. So kind of like a third-party backups, right? That's number eight. Number nine, security monitoring. So a tool that is always constantly scanning your website 24/7. So if there is something going on, an intrusion, the tool is going to be able to alert you right away, send you an email, a text message saying, oh, something's happening here. Take a look, right? So monitoring, security monitoring. And the last one.
Number 10.
Rum draw. The number 10 is have some sort of what's called a web application firewall. So things like Cloudflare, for example, they have a really inexpensive one. I think it's $20 per site. And that's going to stop a lot of the attacks. So it's basically a firewall for your website, right? And the good thing about these nowadays, the firewalls also include CDNs, which is a content delivery network, which means that even if your website is hosted here, let's say Kitchener Waterloo, it's still going to be very fast if somebody's logging in from Vancouver. So that's a CDN, right? So those are my top 10 for e-commerce. There you go.
Amazing. I love it.
I was prepared, man.
You were. That was very good. If anybody out there is listening and they want to reach out to us and asking questions about your site, your servers, et cetera, no obligation. Just don't hesitate. Give us a call and we'll be happy to help you.
Absolutely. Yeah, that was going to be my bonus tip. Tip number 11, speak with Andrew and Dan.
There you go. Thanks, Chris.
All right, guys. Thanks so much for tonight. I greatly appreciate it. I am a big fan of you guys and your show as well. So it was an honor having you here with me tonight. And I look forward to continuing our relationship.
Appreciate it, Chris.
Sounds good, Chris.
Us as well.
Thanks for having us.
Absolutely. Bye.
You've been listening to Delivering E-Commerce. It's our passion to have on leaders and suppliers in e-commerce from around the globe, setting you and your strategy up for the next level. We hope you've gotten some useful and practical information from the show. Make sure to like, rate, and review, and we'll be back soon. Connect with Chris on LinkedIn at Chris Parsons, on LinkedIn and Spotify at Delivering E-Commerce, or on YouTube at Chris Parsons Delivering E-Commerce. Till next time, this is Delivering E-Commerce.